Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
It's fantastic to have you on the show. We have been talking about determination. And I think that's a word that suits you well. Where did you get your determination?
My father said I was born with a fist up in the air. And I don't know where. My sister was also asked, where did Rose get it from? And she said, I don't know. I've just always had this thing against injustice. It's always really bothered me. So I've had a determination to try to just press the reset button on various injustices that we all suffer in life. And to me, if so many people in the world are walking around wounded, then you've got a pretty messed up society that we should try to change. And it's just one of those, what else am I doing? I might as well try to change the world.
You became a leading figure in the Me Too movement. And we're going to talk about that. But first, I have to ask you, because in your book, you describe a very different childhood. And it's a childhood growing up in a cult.
Yes.
Tell me about that cult. What was that?
Well, I grew up in something called Children of God, and there were positives to it. You know, there was a lot of art. There was a lot of music. There was a lot of singing. You were singing about Jesus, but your favorite thing. And
well, I like him. I think he's great.
He was a prophet. He had some stories, you know, from what I've heard.
He's a hippie. I think he was a hippie.
He was a full hippie,
yeah.
And my father looked remarkably like him. And I even told my dad once, I was like, you don't even believe in this stuff. You're like a rock star, and Jesus is your guitar. And I think that holds true.
Your father was kind of a leader?
Yeah, he was the leader of the Italian chapter.
So this was in Italy?
This was in Italy, in a gated commune, if you will. So I didn't really have interaction for most of my life until I got sent to America with other people that were not in this group. And so it caused, like, and it was also multinational, and I don't remember there being any mirrors. So we were raised without any specific focus on gender or race. And being that it was a multinational group, it was, I think, in some ways, there were a lot of positives to being raised that way. There's a lot of negatives. Later, they got into having multiple wives and children and adult sex, which is why we escaped. But it was a very different life, you know, playing on the streets for money when you're little and doing things like that. But it gave me a tool set to start noticing that there are a lot of cults all around us.
But before we come to that, I just wonder, was it like men and women, they had quite different roles in this?
Oh, the women were definitely under the thumbs of men. And that I had a problem with from an early age. It didn't make any sense just because I couldn't see what either was doing that was better than the other.
What's your single most vivid memory from that time? Because you were a child back then.
Yes, I was. Having a woman come in at night and ask me if I'd let God into my heart, to which I would say, not today, try tomorrow. And I wasn't being mean, I just thought maybe tomorrow it'll happen, but not today.
Would they ever punish you?
Of course. But I was just somebody that would rather take that. I always felt like if you tell lies to make somebody else feel better in the short term, then you're chipping away at who you really are, your sense of self. You give that away with each time you fib just to make a situation more comfortable in the short term. And I couldn't do that.
Did you ever rebel?
Yes.
How?
Existing? I don't know. I've always been rebellious. I was a runaway at 13, taken in by two amazing trans women and a stripper named Tina. You know, I have rebelled. I have definitely rebelled against the status quo in the system. You could say that, yes.
But how did you get out of the cult? How did you?
We escaped.
The whole family?
My mother stayed in it for a little while longer, but yes.
And you had to escape? It was like, you're not supposed to leave?
No, you weren't supposed to leave. Yeah. It wasn't. And if you left, you couldn't come back kind of thing. So you really are making a huge change in your life, you know. But when you see things happening to children that aren't kosher, it's best to go.
How was it to meet other children outside after you escaped?
I found them very strange. I found them very strange. I found, especially in America, they were really determined to cut out what was other about you, what was different and special about you, and that there was this really intense need to homogenize everybody, which I fought against and didn't understand. What's it to you if I have, if someone has a personality or looks different or dresses differently or expresses themselves differently? Does that actually affect you in your own life? And if it doesn't, then shut up. You know what I mean?
You went to Hollywood. After a while, you ended up in Hollywood. You got to play great movie parts, and you got a lot to do. What? Who did you become there? Is it possible to say that? Did you become of being a Hollywood person?
Somewhat lost. I think Hollywood, and you've had dealings with it. Ace's place.
Well, I was told, Terry Gilliam said...
Monty Python.
Yeah, from Monty Python. Well, as a director in his own right. Yeah. 12 Monkeys and onwards. I did this thing, an interview chat thing, and he said, you're going to get sucked up by the Hollywood machine. And I wondered if I would. And I'd always been enamoured of Hollywood since I was a kid.
Right.
I broke into Pinewood Studios, one of our British
Amazing.
Studios, when I was 15. Because I wanted to be in films, and yeah, but I do. By the time I got to it, I was so much older. You know, I was hoping to take off when I was 3, but in fact, you know, 7 or something. But no, but when I was 30, or so, it began to work. So about 35, I was getting to Hollywood. So I was, I was not going to be fooled that much, you know. And I was sort of brought in. I came in on a kind of wave, and then I started changing the how I was doing things. And then they said, "Well, we're not interested." They said Hollywood sort of pushed back on me, and I thought, "Okay, well, that's the deal. I'll just do it my own way."
Is this the way it was for you?
It was a bit different because I was discovered when I was 17, and so I thought adults would tell me the truth. Big mistake in Hollywood. Yeah. And it was hard, and it was a really lonely thing. And I was sold my niche, if you will. I was sold as a sex symbol, which I don't think too many of those actually survive Hollywood. They usually either lose their minds or they kill themselves. It's a very rare, weird world to be selling things where your worth is like how much... you know, you can turn men on for the box office. It feels really creepy. And for somebody with my personality, it was really a very hard thing. So what I did was I kind of checked out, and I just played all these roles, and I would just disappear into them. But it took me a long time to realize that I'd stayed out of my body for far too long, and I needed to come and reclaim the space. I do look at Hollywood as a cult, but it is. Anytime you're working to support a system that doesn't support you, that's a cult.
You write about something you call the male gaze. What is that?
Well, the male gaze is something that's been studied and discussed. It's just looking at... it'd be like you have a movie, and then you have the cinematographer, and he's shooting, you know, on the girl's bum, rear side, and then the editor who's editing it so they can show the most of that, and then the director who's trying to get them. So it's like many levels of male gaze are perpetrated within one film. And if you realize that it's about 96% men in the Directors Guild, which is the union of directors that makes all the films, that statistic, 96%, hasn't changed since 1946. So you're having a really steady diet of one person's personality type. And my thing is, that's not a bad personality. We just get to have the other half.
Do you? Do you see this in the sports world as well? Do you ever see sexism in the sports world?
I was lucky. I never met situations like that.
I think it's for sure it was maybe more before, but now it's, in our sport, it's really, really good relationship between this part of problem. So I think it's...
That's great. Yeah. And the country you come from is a lot more integrated with equality, at least on the surface, for everybody, right?
I mean, at least on the surface.
At least on the surface.
Have you considered running as a politician, ever?
I have. And I have this strange desire to run as a Republican. Just to mess it up. Just to mess it up.
you have said once in an interview I read that Donald Trump has a point when it comes to Hollywood, talking about Hollywood.
Well, I was talking about
Hollywood
Trump
elite.
Supporters. They talk about the Hollywood elite as if they're these kind of faux liberals that are doing different things behind the scenes and preaching another thing, and they're not wrong. They can't see what's in their own backyard, but they're not wrong about a lot of Hollywood. That feeling of, you know, I mean, even Malcolm X said he'd rather deal with a Southern racist rather than a Northern liberal because he knows where he stands. And I think there's a certain amount of that in Hollywood, yes.
Has Hollywood disappointed you the last year, apart from the obvious? I mean, so many people have said that they didn't know, they never saw. It's such a surprise.
Yes.
Have you believed them?
No. No, of course not. Because I lived there. I know these people. I was there. I lived with it every day. And I know who knew. And I know it was the majority. And it was just considered like, oh, she's an actress. She wore a short skirt. She deserved it. That's the prevailing wisdom in a lot of industries, but very particularly that one, to which I thought, no, I wore pants that day and nobody deserves it.
Do you think, Rose, that you will be an actress again?
I don't think so.
Why is that?
I never liked it, to be honest. It was my day job, and it was something I was quite good at it. But I've been working on this art project for the last 3.5 years. It's called Planet Nine, and it's a visual and sonic experience. I just realized that I'm an artist in a lot of different ways, not just writing books, which, you know, was a labor of love. That book took me 3.5 years to write. And it's not about the Me Too movement. It's about my life, but also teaching people how to be brave in their own lives. The last lines in it are, I know you can, I know you have it in you just by being brave. And it's really a call to arms. So there's not a lot of space right now. I don't know if it's time in society where we are to do a lot of things in a subtle fashion. So doing things in the movies or playing a superhero in a movie, it just doesn't really appeal to me now.
You I know you cut your hair for a reason.
I kind of realized I broke up with the world. It was really like, because everyone kept asking me, did you break up with somebody? And I thought, no. And then I kind of thought, no, actually, I kind of broke up with just societal expectations of what I was supposed to look like. It wasn't for anybody else, but the side effect was that I noticed that men could hear the words coming out of my mouth for the first time.
What has being such a central figure in the Me Too movement as you've been, what has surprised you the most for the last year?
Just the people on the street that come up to me every day. And, you know, I was at a restaurant the other night and the wait staff came up to me and they said, thank you. It's the first time we're not having to be like, when people are grabbing at us. They said, it's shut it down. And it's not that. It just caused, I think, a real reset with how people view each other and their dynamics, not out of everybody scared to approach somebody, not like that, but in a way that's just about expanding our consciousness. My goal is to see if I could make people kind of, and myself, 10% more aware and awake.
You've been criticized by some for being too furious. And being as that might not be effective for the cause itself. It might be...
I think anger can be a very effective and powerful tool in revolutions. And I think people see anger as this thing to be afraid of, but it might be that it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon and an anger thundercloud passes over and at 4:05 you're off to let me get some tea. It's just a human emotion like any other, and there's a lot to be angry about. And I wouldn't say furious, I would say passionate. And that's really mistaken a lot in women. And if we're supposed to, as humans, experience every kind of emotion, why does that one get taken away from us?
But it's true, we were talking about anger before here, and it seems to me that people react so differently to anger among men or anger among women.
Of course. Mm.
Why is that?
Go back to the dawn of time, just stereotypes and the Bible and religion and subjugation and you have to be pleasing in all things, but that leads us to getting killed and hurt. you know, and we don't have to be. We can be all of it. Like, I consider myself to be a full human being who enjoys a full spectrum of emotions. And I can talk about things that are infuriating, but I can talk about them with about this level of interaction, you know? And it's not like this thing. It's not how it's portrayed. It's very easy to portray people that way. And it's much harder to actually listen to them and hear their tone. Well, my tone is that I'm hopeful. I'm really hopeful for the world. I believe in it.
I while you were talking there, I just, because I like analyzing this because I want to know how humans work. And I think it may be this, it may not be this. The anger, the difference in reaction for an average person to a man being angry and a woman being angry might go back to the earliest stages when death was very easy, all the way up to, you know, the time we had police, what, 300 years ago, the Enlightenment, that's when it started getting, you couldn't actually go and murder someone. And if you go back to the time when murder was easy, Stone Age, I don't know, early stuff, and if a man was angry and you said, you shut up with that anger, they could just kill you. So if they were really angry, really furious, and maybe they were big, you just think, well, I'm just going to let this go. And if a woman was angry, you'd probably think less likely to kill you, and you might push back on that and say, I don't want this anger. You stop being angry with me. And so maybe that has just continued on through the fact that when men get angry, it seems like, well, this could end up in physical violence, even not death, but still physical violence. I do remember someone, when I was a street performer, there was a guy who no one would argue with because there was a threat of physical violence behind everything he said. And you just didn't want to take that on.
You didn't want to be the one that would pop him in
that direction. Yeah, you don't want to say, whoa, I'm in a fight. Oh, God, he's got a knife. I'm dead. So it might be something like that.
Do you agree with that? Or do you think that's a good theory?
You know, if you have centuries upon centuries of pushing down somebody's ability to fully express themselves, if something... I mean, have you ever been angry?
Oh, yeah.
You have a flash.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
But he's
more angry than me, I think.
I can tell.
Part of his training was going out in rush hour, sitting in a car, in a queue.
Cool down a little bit, yes. Because traffic jam is...
It's stress.
So I use that for some training.
That's a good trick.
Yeah.
I should go out and sit in traffic tonight.
Rose, it's been wonderful to have you here. Your book is called Brave, and it's out now. Thank you so much. And thank you all of you for a wonderful night. Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.